morning, everyone, and welcome. Thank you for your patience. Also, if we have any technical difficulties as we proceed, we may have to pause. We do have two panelists from our USAID mission, field missions calling in. My name is Diana Frymus. I work on health workforce development in the Office of HIV and AIDS. So first, a little bit of the context for this webinar. So PEPFAR has funded several studies over the life of the USAID ASSIST project to advance the evidence base for improving the performance and productivity of the community-based health workforce, or CHWs. And so as the ASSIST is coming to a closer in the year ahead, we wanted to take this chance to be able to share the work that has been supported under ASSIST. And as roles for community health workers grow with the rollout of test and start and differentiated care for HIV, the importance of improving and optimizing performance and productivity of this workforce is more critical than ever. There's also an increased need to better understand the factors for how we can guide greater standardization, efficiency, and impact to not ultimately support achievement of epidemic control for HIV, but also as we progress into maintaining achievements made when epidemic control is achieved. So this webinar is going to share findings from research that we've conducted in Uganda and Swaziland. It will also include highlights from our four-country South Africa case study. And we hope to discuss how the findings can be utilized to advance community health worker programming for HIV. We are going to be joined by both URC and USAID mission staff from Uganda and Swaziland. And we look forward to some interesting discussion to advance the HW dialogue. I think we just wanted to kind of, go over some logistics for how our attendees can raise questions throughout the webinar. So you could use the chat function to post questions for any of the speakers by directing the message to all panelists. You can also email questions to Kim Rogers at krogers@usaid.gov. And any responses to questions that aren't addressed during the webinar, we will post them on an event page after the webinar on the USAID ASSIST website. So with that, we're going to move into our first presentation by Sarah Smith Lunsford from URC on productivity and performance amongst village health teams in Uganda. Sarah?
Thank you, Diana. That's great. Thanks. So I'm going to just talk a little bit about a study that we did in Uganda on VHTs, productivity and performance. So the value of CHWs on community health has been well supported by evidence. We all know that. And we sought to really look for, CHW effectiveness and how that's affected by how well they do their work against expected standards, which we define as performance, and how much they can feasibly do, which is their productivity. And then there are these other contextual factors that also come into play on their effectiveness. So performance is really looked at in a lot of different ways in the literature. There's diverse interpretations of what the concept means. And there's some of these definitions kind of overlap with what productivity is. So for our purposes, we kind of wanted to simplify and separate these two elements. So for performance is defined as the extent to which tasks or services are completed according to standards. So more how well tasks are done. And productivity is looked at as being the volume of services or how much is done. If we understand these factors a little bit more, we can figure out how to best deploy and support our CHWs to maximize their effectiveness. There's been a lot more research done on CHW performance, less research done on CHW productivity, and negligible research done to the best of our knowledge, on the relationship between these two elements, between productivity and performance. So just to take a moment to remind ourselves what VHTs in Uganda do. At the time of this study, the data were collected a couple of years ago, VHTs were responsible for seven key tasks. The VHT program was started in 2000 by the Ugandan Ministry of Health with the hope that they would empower communities to really take part in their decisions that affect health, mobilize communities around health, and then strengthen the delivery of services to the community. They're unsalaried. They are connected to the lowest level of the healthcare system, the Health Center 1 in Uganda. To be selected as a VHT, you must be 18 years old, reside in the village, be literate in the local language, and capable of community mobilization and communication, be dependable, trustworthy, and then have an interest in health and development. Ideally, there would be one male and one female VHT selected, but obviously we know that that's not always the case. So VHTs are responsible for about 30 households within their communities, and they have these seven tasks to report, to collect data on the catchment population, to practice or model health behaviors, to provide health services and referrals, to link the community members to the formal healthcare system, to mobilize the community and health workers for health activities, to conduct household visits, and then to support those living with HIV and other illnesses. In recent years, there's been increasing tasks shifted to VHTs to strengthen community support for people living with HIV, including mapping HIV patients in the community, linking them to linking patients to VHTs and other resources, engaging community groups to support HIV patients in other areas, including nutrition, psychosocial support, savings and loan, et cetera. Their VHTs have been found to really have an important role in providing improved health services and outcomes and ensuring improved outcomes among communities in Uganda. Since the study, we've found that VHTs really can help move towards a community-based, patient-centered HIV health services. There have been approximately 179,000 VHTs trained since 2001, so since the program was started, but about 30% have left their position. There is national coverage with them operating in all 112 districts of Uganda, and there has been research that indicates that insufficient supplies and transportation may impact their productivity. So looking specifically at what we were trying to achieve with this study, we wanted to describe the VHT productivity and performance in Busia District in Uganda, explore the relationship between productivity and performance, and then investigate some independent factors that influence productivity and performance. The idea was that this study would contribute to the global evidence on strategies to improve CHW productivity and performance with an eye towards better understanding factors that could increase their effectiveness. So we conducted a cross-sectional study to assess the VHT productivity and performance. Data were collected between March and May 2013, so it was a couple years ago, and to quantify productivity and performance, we looked only at two of the seven tasks that VHTs are responsible for: saving lives, so providing direct health services and referrals, and visits, household visits. So data were collected through multiple sources. In one, the data collector observed VHTs assessing sick children and pregnant women for danger signs during a home visit. The VHT recorded what he or she found, and then immediately after that, the data Dr. conducted a gold standard evaluation of the child or the pregnant woman, and then those were compared. During the same visit, the quality of the interaction, and so this would be a performance, these are both performance indicators. So the quality of the interaction, including the length of time and travel time, were recorded. Data collectors were instructed to build rapport with VHTs to really try to minimize any issues around being observed. And then we also looked at routine data already being collected by the VHTs, so their village maps, their registers, their monthly summary forms, and these were reviewed both for completeness and to quantify frequency of activities, so that would be more of a productivity indicator. And then we also administered surveys to VHTs and supervising health facility staff to collect data on individual characteristics of the VHTs. So moving on to what we learned from these data. So for productivity, we constructed a composite score, which is the CSI, which is an adaptation from a score used by the WHO. And we found that, so for just to, for interpretation basis, each unit on the CSI is equivalent to a single home visit. So we found that there was quite a wide range between 2 and 115 visits conducted within the 3-month span that we used for data collection, which is quite a wide range, with an average of 21 visits conducted. For performance, generally we found that performance was quite high. This was 100, so there was an average performance score of 91, and then with a range of 51 to 100. We also identified some other covariates that were associated with productivity and performance. For productivity, older VHT age and VHT's knowledge of danger signs were significantly associated with greater productivity. Other VHT characteristics, such as engagement and competency, were not significantly associated with productivity. Years serving as a VHT had a marginally significant positive association with productivity. And then if we moved on to performance, job satisfaction and knowledge of danger signs were significant. So we found that for every unit increase in job satisfaction, the performance score was increased by 1.46. And for every 10% increase in knowledge of danger signs, the performance score also increased by 1.02. At a slightly less significant level, at the 0.1 level, we found that mothers who were greater than 18 years old had VHTs whose performance was lower than mothers who were younger, and every additional year of maternal education, for every additional year of maternal education of the pregnant women that they assessed, the VHTs performed worse, which is an interesting finding, but it is less significant. So implications. So we observed that there's really a minimal correlation between measures of VHT productivity and performance in Buya District. And there was no covariate that we could identify that was significantly associated with both measures, implying that there's no evidence that performance was being sacrificed for increased productivity or vice versa. There was also no evidence that indicates that if you improve productivity, it would contribute to improved performance, or if you improved performance, it would contribute to improved productivity, or that there were specific characteristics of the VHTs or environments that would be that could be targeted to improve both. This really highlights the need for conscious policy planning that recognizes that these two components of VHT effectiveness, productivity and performance, may need to be potentially integrated or could be integrated, but nevertheless, interventions need to be independent. So you need to intentionally design for interventions to improve productivity, and intentionally designed for interventions to improve performance. So this is particularly important for efforts to improve VHT effectiveness within HIV-related tasks, such as providing self-management support for people with HIV, which can be time-consuming if performed appropriately. So if you get a better performance for self-management support, then you're probably going to have a lower productivity among that VHT. So this study immediate implications for improving VHT effectiveness in Uganda are first to explore why the study found such large variability in the number of home visits performed, so that why there was such variability in the productivity between 14 and 115 visits. If home visits are seen as an especially important task in community-based HIV services. So we may want to think about productivity benchmarks for key services that could be utilized to provide a little bit more detail and a more of an accurate measure per se. We also need to think about, you know, how can we address VHT competency and job satisfaction to increase performance. So the implications for HIV services, we want to balance productivity and performance on these time-intensive tasks. Certainly want increased attention to monitoring workload, which requires systems like supportive supervision, ensure HIV competency, which is also, you know, linked to supervision, mentorship, and in-service training opportunities. Age, we may want to think about efforts to retain older VHTs. And then we certainly need further research as Uganda moves from volunteers to paid CHWs. In 2014-2015 assessment of VHTs, the many, many ongoing challenges related to funding, supervisory systems, equipment and supplies, documentation and reporting, referral systems, et cetera, were identified. And as a result of that assessment, the Ugandan government decided to create a community health extension worker strategy that would create a cadre of CHWs that are part of the health system, who are competent, who are and compensated. And the strategy covers 2015 to 2020. And so more research will be needed to really examine the impact of this strategy on the quality of services, performance, and productivity, and then ultimately health outcomes. And then thinking about also how do we understand these concepts of performance and productivity? You know, as Diana mentioned in her opening remarks, you know, the responsibilities being shifted to community health workers are ever-changing and ever-growing. So we need to continually monitor their performance and productivity as they take on these new roles and responsibilities. And then, you know, one of the things that, you know, I'm an anthropologist, so I have very specific sort of thoughts in mind about these, but one of the things that came to mind for me was that this study really didn't explore qualitatively what was going on, and so coupling these quantitative studies with qualitative exploration into exactly, to get into exactly a little bit more of what's going on, especially when you think about you know, the productivity, why there was such that such variability in the productivity, you know, that could be supplementing that with qualitative methods to really understand what was happening there would lead to a more robust picture and a bit more guidance, if you will, about how to tailor interventions to improve both the productivity and the performance of community health workers. And I think that's it for me. So are there any questions?
Great, thanks, Sarah. I think we have one question so far from our attendees, from Tim Quick. Given ASSIST is known for its quality improvement leadership, was the basic QI approach applied to the productivity and performance study in Uganda?
So this study was just a cross-sectional. It didn't come with an intervention. It was really just trying to understand what was going on. So there was no improvement approach or improvement interventions attached to it.
Great. We have another question from Eckhard Klein. Remuneration and superstition, I think, can be important for performance and productivity. Can you say something about it?
So this study didn't So this study didn't specifically look at compensation and supervision. So we did interview the VHTs and their supervisors. That was more to sort of get some of the characteristics of the VHTs, but not really about the quality of the supervision or perceptions around it. But I agree with you, there is certainly, remuneration and supervision are certainly motivating factors, and there's much literature written about that. A lot more of it has been looked at in among paid health workers. It's a little less so done, I think, among community health workers, I think because there's an assumption that that they're not being compensated, but I think that there's a lot more to learn around that, for sure.
Great, we have another question from Crystal Duncan. Could you clarify the roles for VHTs regarding HIV?
So this study actually looked specifically, the clinical observations that they were evaluated for were actually not HIV related. So they were looking at danger signs among pregnant women and children. I would actually defer to Wilberforce when he's available to talk about specifically because the roles of VHTs have changed since this study was done. So I think that he could probably speak a little bit more eloquently about specifically what they've been tasked to do with respect to HIV.
Great, thanks, Sarah. And with that, I think, Lonnie, can we loop in Wilberforce?
Wilberforce, can you try to speak now? I think I have you unmuted.
Yeah, this is Wilberforce from Uganda. Good morning or good afternoon.
Good morning. Good afternoon. Thanks for joining us, Wilberforce. We have a couple of questions for you. This is Diana, and I'm going to start off with the first question. So, recognizing that this study conducted by ASSIST is several years old. And I think connecting to Crystal's question that we just had, can you talk a little bit about how the roles of VHTs and other community-based workers in Uganda have evolved in supporting HIV?
Yeah, thank you so much for the question. One on the evolution of village health teams in Uganda, one, I would say that from time immemorial, it was a good practice for community members or neighbors would visit each other, more particularly the sick. And in the process of that kind of visiting, the instance would be about to psychosocial support and encouraging them to seek treatment, and those who are very sick to see how to support the neighbor, the people within their network. But over time, and also responding to the need, to the challenges within the health sector, it was noted that the community movement, as I would call it, was a resource that could be tapped. But also, there were challenges that needed to be addressed, more particularly to ensure that as the community members visit each other, there was need to ensure that they are disseminating correct information in terms of behavior change communication. Then they are able to correct the link to the appropriate referral networks, more particularly for HIV and health care, to the linkage to the health facilities. But also it ensures that particularly for HIV, there is appropriate adherence support, where, for example, the patients would look for neighbors or relatives to serve as the treatment buddies. So in terms of the evolution, it felt important to ensure that those community members are trained and they are equipped with the necessary tools in terms of behavior change communication or IEC materials and registers, and they are supported. So I would say it evolved from the community social goodwill that was existing, a regulated practice that where we had the VHTs that were trained and monitored and linked, and also to ensure that they are responding to the challenges within the health sector, more particularly insufficiency of the health workforce, and hence the essence of bring on board the component of task shifting to see what kind of roles could be shared between the health workers and the community members. So in terms of the evolution, initially we had a movement that was not trained, the trained and regulated a workforce that was still voluntary, and currently we are going into a phase where we want the community members or the VHTs who are part of the formal structure and they are supervising the community network. So to the question of the roles and responsibilities of VHTs in the current arrangement of HIV, they are mainly supporting adherence support, mainly about counseling and retention of patients into care, but also they support they do stigma reduction counseling, and they also do behavior change communication, but also they have continued doing the psychosocial support that includes the economic enhancement and members and supporting doing the broader family social support. That is a component that is important, that he also supports the retention and the improved well-being of the HIV patients. Over to you.
Thanks, Wilberforce. That evolution is really helpful to better understand, and we know that the roles are ever expanding for this level of workforce, especially as we're further roll out differentiated care for HIV programs. Can you talk, going to our next question, can you talk a little bit about perhaps what strategies you feel like have been effective to support performance and productivity? What are the outstanding concerns? We had a question from one of the attendees around whether or not VHTs have standards or benchmarks in terms of expectations. Do those things exist? Are they, frequently kind of measured or looked at?
Yeah, thank you so much for that question. My understanding, performance is a function of the quality of services the VHTs perform. And the number of factors in a Ugandan perspective that affect its performance. And I would say some of these factors are intrinsic and some are extrinsic. But the intrinsic that are inborn that we may not do much about in the Ugandan concept that we have seen, one is the factor of age. People who are mature, they tend to do a much better quality service. Then female gender, they tend to do well, mainly because of the social cultural perspective, because the women tend to be closer to the sick and they are able to understand and empathize with them. But also what we have seen is the affected and the infected VHTs from HIV perspective tend to do better, where, for example, in Uganda, we have the VHTs that we have called the VHTs who are at the same time patients, and we call them expert clients because they have gone through the system, they are part of the patients, and they are, with additional training, they tend to do much better compared to the VHTs who are not infected or affected. But also there are extrinsic issues that we have seen. Issues to do with the level of training the VHTs receive, the kind of curriculum they receive, the duration of training, and the kind of supervision they are receiving. And what we have seen is the supervision is more to do with the health worker who is attached to the VHTs, how the kind of relationship they have and they're able to establish in terms of linking with the patients. But also the level of quality support and reviewing of the reports, so that the VHTs are able to be informed of how well they are doing, and if there are any gaps, then those gaps are informed and shared, and they are able to focus on those gaps. And so these are some of the things that in our Ugandan perspective that are seen to be determining the performance. But also it depends also on the kind of community the VHTs live in. There are communities that tend to have groups, either women groups or patients groups, and so also existing groups, they predetermine the quality of performance of the VHTs. Oh, there was a question on whether there are any concerns. Of course, there are many concerns, there are a number of concerns that are emerging. One of the concerns is the attrition and the voluntarism, where most VHTs and it's a voluntary service, and at times, because of the workload, we tend to exceed the boundaries of voluntarism, and you find it ends up becoming more or less a full-time job, whereby you find also the VHT has a home to support, and there are those concerns as to whether the kind of workload they are doing is within the limits of voluntarism. Over to you.
Great, thanks, Wilberforce. We're just going to jump to our last question for you. Can you talk to us a little bit about the current update on the discussions around the VHTs and developing a paid cadre in Uganda? I think it's being called the 2 strategy. And how will this specifically impact HIV services? So is there a discussion around the role of this new cadre in supporting HIV?
Like I indicated in the evolution of the VHT and community health workforce, from the untrained to the trained, now we are moving to the VHTs who are part of the formal structure. So the thinking in Uganda is to introduce another layer of community health workforce that operates at a beyond the village level, at a parish level, where they will be supervising and coordinating the other VHTs, and the primary purpose is to ensure that they are properly supporting the linkage and referrals to the facilities, and they are so that they are also improve on the documentation so that we are able to learn from our experience. But the most important, it also address the current challenge of voluntarism, so that the VHTs are part of the paid and salaried structure. And in so doing, the intention is to ensure that we are able to have a sustainable community structure through which a number of interventions that are introduced by, for example, the IPs, they can be, the VHTs that are trained by IPs can be transitioned through this formally trained and salaried workforce as part of the sustainability. But with the intention of ensuring that we are able to improve and document, facilitate community linkages and community facilitate referrals in a more standardized and more sustainable formal kind of structure, so that we're able to complete the loop of referrals and linkages from the communities.
Great, thanks so much. Thanks, well, of course, this is really helpful also to get the current context of Uganda. As we just learned about the study, noting that that it was conducted several years back. So thanks so much for joining us. With that, we're going to move forward to our next panelist, Edward Broughton. He's going to talk about two specific studies that were conducted in Swaziland, one to look at harmonization of community health workers. And I'm sure a lot of our attendees have heard this global dialogue around the need for harmonization of community health worker programs. And I think we'll learn a little bit about how we could utilize the principles of harmonization to guide further impact, efficiency, and sustainability of community health worker programs, specifically also in contexts where we know there are multiple community cadres supporting HIV and other services, where there could be both national and also donor or NGO-supported programs. So Edward, with that, we look forward to learning about Swaziland.
Okay, thanks very much, Diana. I'm going to go through these slides fairly quickly. It's important for the participants to know that these will be posted and, online, so they'll be available to refer to. So don't be concerned that I'm going through them very quickly. We don't have that much time, and I want to give as much time to Grace, who's actually sitting in Swaziland, and the things that she has to say about community health workers is very important and valuable, and we want to get as much time as possible to that. So we've already talked a lot about the importance of community health workers, so I don't need to go through that. For Swaziland, it has a high HIV prevalence, as we all know, and there was good progress in addressing HIV reported at the 2017 AIDS conference, and so it's great to see that progress, but there is still need for even greater an even greater response, and the shortage of physicians and nurses in Swaziland is a major barrier in utilizing that. And these physicians and nurses, they're not just going to magically appear anytime soon, and so using community health workers is seen as a very important way to ameliorate the problem of addressing the HIV epidemic there. We identified five cadres of community health workers operating in Swaziland, the largest of which are the rural health motivators, or RHMs, and they number about 5,000. These cadres have different levels of training and requirements. But they're all measured in weeks, not months or years. So, you know, these are not people who are extensively trained. They receive organizational support from different non-governmental and donor sources. And it's the rural health motivators that are that predominate, and they are they get their support from the Ministry of Health in Swaziland. Next. Rural health motivators and community counselors provide services to the general population, and so they have a wider mandate than the other cadres. And those are the mother-to-mother and the expert clients who really are very specifically for HIV response. The main research question addressed in these studies that we're presenting is what was the most efficient and effective way to improve and sustain community health worker performance. The two studies conducted to address these are how does the community health worker performance logic model inform community health worker programs and what are the facilitators and barriers to harmonization in the four-country case study that we're about to present. So for the logic model, it's all based on this model that was presented in a paper in Human Resources for Health Journal in 2014, and it's authored by colleagues from the ASSIST Project and from USAID, including Diana Primus, our chair today. And that's for your reference, and we will actually have an attachment to that in the presentation, so you can refer to that paper originally in its original format. Next. It is a framework developed to guide policy and programming in improving community health worker performance. This study here that we're talking about now was designed to apply the model in Swaziland with the aim of providing insight into how to improve the and sustain community health worker programs and what are the main factors that contribute to this. The study involved a household survey asking questions about community health worker services received, and there were over 300 interviews also conducted of rural health motivators themselves, and there was also a qualitative interview series on the four other cadres that were operating in Swaziland at the time. So three distinct parts to this study. Next. In terms of inputs for community health worker programs, funding is disproportionately low for rural health motivators. They are paid the equivalent of $60 US per month. Other cadres of community health workers are compensated at higher rates, and some of them substantially higher. And the materials they are given to perform their tasks and also to distribute to recipients of their services are also seen as inadequate. So this was actually a common theme throughout both the rural health motivators and the other cadres of health workers. At the system level, rural health motivators are governed by the Ministry of Health, while the smaller cadres are organized by non-governmental organizations or donor funds, as we said before, and they have different eligibility criteria and training associated with those programs. There are also differences in the services provided. So it's, as I said, the expert clients and the mentors are responsible for HIV services, whereas the community councillors and the RHMs are provide a wider array of services. Next. For outputs, only 50% of households recall having a visit by a rural health motivator in the previous year or the year previous to the questionnaire being administered. And they are mandated, the rural health motivators, to visit every household at least once a year. So this is a significant departure from what was expected. Only 15% of the households have been visited by a non-rural health motivator, cadre of community health worker. And there was slightly better satisfaction among those who were visited by the non-rural health motivators compared to the rural health motivators, but neither of those were particularly high, it should be said. Most of the community health workers don't think that they are adequately compensated, which is as expected from the previous comments that they get paid only $60 a month. And for supervision and in-service training, the respondents, both the rural health motivators and the other cadres, were quite positive or reasonably positive about their experience with supervision. They usually responded that they did have good relationships and that they were receiving good guidance from their supervisors, which was good to see. Next. Following the logic model fields, outputs for the rural health motivators were mostly health education and childhood vaccine administration. So there was far less HIV and TB testing reported. So this is for the 5,000 community rural health motivators. They're really not providing a huge degree of services for HIV, whereas the other cadres are much more focused on those. Next. So to conclude, the coverage of community health worker program is less than mandated, and that satisfaction is not as high for any of the community health workers, but it's slightly lower for the rural health motivators. For the logic model, in terms of it as a tool to guide evaluations, it performs well, and it is comprehensive in covering all reasonable factors that might impact performance of community health worker programs. And it was very useful in structuring the evaluation and the questioning in the survey instruments. So it was actually very useful for that. Okay, so the second study is the country case study, the four-country case study for harmonization. And first, the definition of harmonization that was used in the study is the increased coordination, integration, and sustainability of the community health worker programs. So harmonization of CHW programs within a country is thought to have a positive effect on efficiency and effectiveness and sustainability, and all are important in reaching the 90-90-90 goals. The purpose of the study was to find out the facilitating factors and inhibiting factors for the harmonization process and to develop policy recommendations to promote harmonization with the goal of improving efficiency and effectiveness of the programs themselves. The reason we selected these countries is because they have high HIV burdens and they generally have large CHW programs or large, at least one large program, but they also have parallel donor or NGO-supported CHW programs. It is interesting to think of why such parallel programs exist. There must be at least a perceived need for additional services in the community, at the community level. And that means that there must be some needs that are not being met by the central or the main community health worker program. And it could be from underperformance of the existing programs, or perhaps they are overwhelmed by the increase in the need and perhaps they're not as able to be as flexible and as adaptable to changing needs. You know, we are coming up or at the central level, there are initiatives to start differentiated care and test and treat and all of these kind of new methods of providing services for HIV, addressing the HIV crisis. But it is interesting that we don't really think too much about the ability of the community health worker organizations to address these in a responsive manner. So we looked at three domains of harmonization: coordination, so was there duplication or overlapping of services; integration, was there coordination of roles and responsibilities and training; and sustainability, was there long-term funding available for the program. So these are the four countries that were selected. Next, I'm not going to go through the framework. You can refer to that later. Next. And here are some of the questions that were asked, and this is again for your later reference. Next, so some of the facilitators, so there are, here is a fairly comprehensive list. Some of those that were common across all four countries were having large national community health worker programs, and there being recognition of non-Ministry of Health community health worker programs. Similar job descriptions were seen across all of the countries, and there was engagement of community leaders. Whether that was extensive engagement or not is another question, but there certainly was at least attempts at getting good community engagement in these places. Next. Some of the barriers common across all countries are the lack of accountability of non-CHW programs, and one could also argue that there is some lack of accountability at the centrally funded programs as well. And also a lack of human resources generally. So I guess that's not too surprising with the low level of compensation and sometimes the high burden for the community health workers. Next. So in conclusion, there was underperformance in the service delivery and the client needs were unmet, and that spurred a perceived gap that could be filled by other charters, and so that's why these charters are developed, and that's why there's fragmentation of the services. And the multiple charters can lead to inefficiencies and inequities and less accountability because there are more organizations involved in that. Next. Also, the resources and the skills limitation does impede the functioning of the community health workers. Better alignment for community health worker education standards, training, and incentives can reduce disparities in performance. And harmonization can actually reduce some of these things, but it is not the answer to all of these problems, and that's an important thing to recognize here. There is a reason for there to be a fragmentation of these services, and it's important to recognize that and to address these issues when we think about harmonization, because just saying the word harmonization is just not going to make things come together unless all of these other underlying issues are addressed adequately. Okay, so that was my quick run through the studies, and now we will, I'll send it back to Diana.
Thanks, Edward, and I just want to add on to your last point. I think there's this misconception around what harmonization means, and is it mean a full kind of merge or integration into a single community health worker program? And so I think it would be good to kind of better tease out that harmonization, you know, applying harmonization principles doesn't necessarily mean, you know, that you're merging everything into one program, but you're just looking to identify where you can better standardize or guide efficiencies. And I think that's an important point. I think we had one question from the first study regarding the study design. If you can talk a little bit more about the logic model study design and how the study was structured.
Sure. I can't see the question.
One was the Swaziland study design, experimental pre-post with control without cross-sectional, etc.
Right, so it was a cross-sectional study that was actually conducted by our colleagues at Harvard, and it was, an observational study, so there was no intervention, there was no pre-post, and it was the household survey was conducted on a little over 2,000 households that were randomly selected in two of the districts of Swaziland, and it was a fairly comprehensive qualitative study, and I can share, if anybody is interested, some of the more specific results. There have been a couple of papers that have been generated from these activities, because obviously a lot of the detail is missed in a presentation like this. The other part was a series of 300 interviews with just rural health motivators and their supervisors to find out more about that specific program. And then there was a third component, which was qualitative interviews with some of the non-rural health motivator charters as well. But it was
great. Just another question on the logic model study. If you look at the findings and the results, it's clear that in the program design and implementation of the various programs, there wasn't equal emphasis placed on, if you look, compare it to the logic model, on the system level and the program level activities. So could you speak a little bit more to then maybe how you feel like the logic model could guide further investigations in countries in terms of informing interventions that could be designed to strengthen and improve existing programs?
Yeah, that's a tough one. I mean, I see the logic model as providing a good framework for doing these observational studies. In terms of the effectiveness of actually addressing the issues that are illuminated in this kind of observational study, I think we can come up with possible policy solutions or programmatic solutions at the lower level, but I think they really need to be tested. You know, we're all about quality improvement here and implementing changes and seeing how they work and having this iterative process. And I think that's really what needs to happen here. I don't, and sort of, Diana, feel free to say otherwise, but I don't see the logic model as a tool that, you know, gives solutions as such, but it suggests ways of looking at the implementation of community health worker programs and a way to separate out various components for observation and for giving ideas to implement changes that might address some of the issues that are discovered.
Right, and I would agree with that, and I think what it could be utilized as is to identify maybe where there's been lesser emphasis on certain areas. For example, social support at the community level, or in the other bucket areas that then could be considered as should, you know, a program consider to strengthen or to try a new intervention in this area as a means to strengthen the program. So it definitely is a guide that hopefully could be further utilized. I think we have one question before we move to Grace on the harmonization study from Eckerd. So his question is, there seems to be at least five different types of community health workers in Swaziland. What were the key issues related to harmonization across the types, and how could harmonization be achieved in Swaziland?
Yeah, and this one I think might be better for Grace to actually address, because there are issues with the Rural Health Motivator Program itself to begin with, and whether other parts should be kind of merged into that. I don't know that that is the solution, as Diana was saying, that there could be issues with that. So I'll let Grace address that, if that's okay.
Sounds good. Okay, Grace, are you on the line?
Yes, I am, Diane.
Hi, Grace. Welcome. Thank you for joining us today. Everyone, this is Grace Masuku from our USAID Swaziland mission. Grace, we have a couple of questions for you today, so I'm going to jump ahead into the questions. Does that work?
That will work, Diane.
Great. Our first question, maybe a little bit out of order from the we'll get to Eckerd's question in a little bit, but the first question that we have for you is, you know, and Eckerd talked about the recent progress that has just been reported in Swaziland towards achieving 90-90-90, and I think there are a lot of questions in the HIV community around how Swaziland has been able to make this success. And so from your experience, can you talk a little bit about how you feel like community health workers, community-based workers have supported the advances that Swaziland has made?
Thank you, Diane. Just to point on the study that was done, I think we really have a lot of appreciation for the funding that the country was able to get from PEPFAR, being a high prevalence country, where even the whole ethos around how the government looks at addressing the gaps in terms of the HR made it evident that we needed to shift from a model where you were looking at doctors for initiation. The art initiation moved heavily to nurses that were readily available in terms of numbers because we are producing the nurses as opposed to the doctors. And that actually gave room for the many different cadres that PEPFAR has supported. We are talking about the cadres that are supporting just the HTC services so that you are able to test, and also the whole expert client chain that and cadres that have been developed. And in addition to that is also with OVC and prevention, there have been a number of cadres that have been just, supported by PEPFAR and other partners, namely the Global Fund. Now, that has had very positive, you know, outcomes in terms of how we have responded as a country to the Natchez-led, initiation and the supportive cadres, as in lay cadres, to a situation where we are also seeing overlaps, because we are reacting to a situation where we needed to get treatment readily out there in decentralized. So the fact that now we are looking at some of the overlaps, and the beauty of the study is actually forcing us to look at how we look at optimization, how we look at rationalizing, so that the multiple cadres that we supported, we are able to go back to the drawing board to say, how do these job scopes fit? And I think that has been one of the major successes, where government worked closely with the partners to make sure that they created that space for that to happen, because it was a response that needed immediate attention.
Great, thanks, Grace. That's helpful. If we go to the second question, and so you were talking a little bit about the utility of the activities and the findings. Can you talk a little bit more about how you've been able to utilize the results of these activities in your dialogue with government and other stakeholders and countries to further inform? You spoke a little bit about how it helped identify the need for further rationalization and optimization, but can you talk a little bit more about how the results have been used? I think specifically also because there was a significant emphasis on the Rural Health Motivator Program that is a government-funded program. If any of the results also were very useful to government in terms of thinking around how to further support the RHM program.
And I think for purposes of giving some kind of a milestone as to when we then had the research, in 2014, we already aligned ourselves for 1990-90. Where HQ, both in the interagency space, piloted the tool for the assessment that we conducted. And we were looking at the lay cadres then in 2014 that were really in the facilities. And there's been a lot of learnings from just how we tried to make sure that we had uniform engagement of these cadres using a several level agreement, where we worked with government to make sure that we had that. And then we looked at also the stipends that we were paying for our lay cadres in the facilities, and also that we had some kind of uniform job descriptions across our partners, because we also realized that with the regionalization of the treatment program, we needed to address all of those discrepancies or differences that we had amongst our PEPFAR partner or in the PEPFAR program. So the streamlining preceded the study. So when we then had the study conducted, we were keen to just make sure that we looked at some of these data sets from a program implementation point of view, so that in COP17, for the streamlining of the community cadre, we are piggybacking on the research findings from that study, where we are looking at a thorough community mapping assessment beyond the two regions, plus also other cadres looked at in the study, to just make sure that we know who is out there and what are they doing and where they are working. And in fact, the wide dissemination has helped us a lot, because we have had a wide dissemination at senior government level, just to make sure that they are understanding the implications of some of the work that has been funded by partners, and I'm talking about partners here, namely Global Fund and PEPFAR, to really address the gaps that are evidently going to affect Swaziland post-HIV funding, because a lot of these cadres that we have actually populated in community and facility are really holding the service delivery, health service delivery intact. And there's been a realization and an endorsement by government that, you know, when we see this study results, when we see some of the assessments that we have had in terms of just the treatment program, we realize that there's a huge gap. So in COP17, we are really going to take this study, the findings, and make sure that we really go beyond what the study did to look at even the prevention cadres, so that we have a clear sense of the mapping, where people are working, how they are accountable, and also how we address the issue of harmonization within the program, harmonization at national level as well, where we are looking at an operational model that would actually contextualize the logic model for us as Swaziland, because of the circumstances that we find ourselves in with, you know, the youth bulge, where the prevention pieces need to be very strong, and therefore the cadres that we are supporting, and also the fact that we still have to maintain people in treatment. So yes, we may be considered a country that has been very successful, right? But in terms of maintaining the status quo and making sure that we are moving the country to sustainability, this harmonization study or assessment in COP17 is really going to make sure that PEPFAR Government Global Fund collectively are looking at this space, because it is critical, and that we are devising, you know, methods and funding approaches and programming approaches that are going to resonate with government, resonate with the communities, so that whatever support is being given to the country is sustainable. And I think, in conclusion, on just the issues around this study and what should happen is the task shifting framework, where yes, the framework was developed, and now that we have some of the research findings, now that we have data that is now beginning to talk HRH current, who do you have, where are they, what are they doing, we can begin talking more objectively with the task shifting with government, especially with Minister of Public Service, because they have really been standoffish in terms of engaging Ministry of Health in implementing the task shifting. I think for us, this study came in at the right time when we had gone through this other assessment with the stakeholders in the facilities. So we were already appreciating some of the overlaps. And moving forward is going to be then how do we take the learnings from that and the learnings from the study, so that we look at a more sustainable lay cadre group that is going to be modeled around a government or public sector health delivery system, so that where there are opportunities to absorb these people or these the lay cadres, we can engage meaningfully with government.
Thanks, Grace. And I think you touched a little bit upon my last question, but let's put it up. And I think, you know, you spoke around the need for now considering maintenance. And I think that that's really, really, really important for countries like Swaziland and other countries who are really advancing towards achieving 90-90-90 targets. And it requires, as you noted, different discussions, because you start thinking about long-term needs that will be needed to put in place to be able to maintain and sustain. I think we have a question that I just want to read you that gets to some of this. and it's from Renee Berger. So he says, Swaziland is on the cusp of achieving the 90-90 target. However, there will still be portions of the population with a very high HIV prevalence and a clear need for strong adherence activities to maintain these targets. How confident are you that community health workers can carry out this task of maintaining adherence and also continue to integrate differentiated care models into the community?
Well, with the assessment that we are going to be conducting, we are looking at not only a uniform engagement of the legislators using some kind of a uniform of selecting them, where we look at the professionalizing the cadres that we have created, so that to maintain what we have achieved will take a better organized community work health workforce, one where we have documented who is where, what are they doing, how have they been trained, how do we train them, and how do we supervise them. It's actually going to take a big shift from what we've been doing in the last so many years of PEPFAR, where we are accountable, we are making sure that these programs are accountable, and that we are benchmarking how we select and train them to a point where there is some sort of credentialing of these cadres. And this discussion is one that government is already beginning to look at more closely with the data that we produced more recently in the HRH, current data. So I think we do realize that the successes that we've made mean that we are vigilant with whatever assessment we're going to be conducting in the current period. And also a better and systemized training approach, where we define the skills and skill sets, because we know that we were really handing people, actually training people who were coming from all walks of life, and they were able to be trained for few weeks to be able to do the job. But now, if we're talking about really a high caliber cadre of lay cadres that are trained better, it's going to have to take a very different approach. And I think this is one of the take-home messages that we've had in different platforms.
Great. Thanks so much, Grace. I think the global community will be continuing to look at Swaziland for solutions and considerations, but also to continue to see the progress that you are making. With that, I just have, before we end, I have a couple of key takeaways for us. If we can move the slide. Great. So, in conclusion from today's presentation and discussion, we note that there continues to be a great variability of community health programs across countries, and that the roles for these cadres for HIV continue to expand, especially as there's continued rollout of test and start and differentiated care models. And I would add also the need to start to project on what that maintenance of epidemic control looks like, and then how roles will have to evolve even more to be able to maintain HIV progress. We spoke about Sarah made this recommendation for the need for increased focus on continual monitoring of both community health worker performance and productivity and delivery of HIV services. And in an era where we're very data-driven in the HIV space, we don't put a lot of focus on looking at and continuing to monitor health worker performance and productivity. So I think this is an important thing for consideration and how we can be looking to continually ensure optimal utilization of these cadres in context, specifically also where there are constrained HRH environments, especially where maybe the clinical workforce shortages are widespread. And a lot of comments from the audience on needing to look at workload and how, you know, discussions around community health workers managing HIV tasks and other tasks. And I think this is critical for a lot of government cadres where they're being designed, of course, to take on multiple roles. And I think that also puts in other areas of consideration where we, as a community, need to continue to look at. We learned a little bit about the application of the community health worker logic model and how it could be a useful tool in planning and monitoring and even an assessment of community health worker performance for HIV. And then also recognizing that the community health worker context in most countries includes a combination of both country and donor NGO supported programs, and how increased focus on harmonization of programs can hopefully yield greater effectiveness, efficiency, and sustainability, which is critical for ensuring sustained progress, but also as we achieve epidemic control, then working to maintain that epidemic control. So with that, I want to give my thanks to URC staff in organizing and in the work that was put into all of these studies, and also for Grace and Wilberforce joining us today. It was great to have a representation from USAID from our field staff. And to all of our attendees today, thanks for staying with us for the full hour and a half. I think if there are any questions that we didn't answer, as Londi mentioned, we will put responses and we'll send out a link to the USAID ASSIST website where you can view the recording and the questions, responses rather, to all of the questions. So thank you so much, and have a good rest of the day or a good evening to everyone who's joined us.